On behalf of South Asians for Human Rights, I have to thank the media who had responded to our invitation. We convened this press briefing after facilitating women's mission, and we call it the South Asian Women's Peace Mission to Sri Lanka. South Asians for Human Rights is a non-governmental NGO comprising of lawyers, civil society activists, human rights defenders from most of the SAARC countries, and the secretariat is based in Sri Lanka. South Asians for Human Rights broadly want to promote human rights protection and also enhancing rule of law, independence of judiciary, and also affirm the work of human rights defenders, human rights movement, social activists to deepen democracy, enhance good governance in South Asian countries. We know as people living in South Asia that we would want to promote people-to-people interaction in our struggle for justice, equality and protection of all citizens, including the minorities, religious minorities, ethnic minorities, indigenous communities in South Asia. We who represent South Asian countries know the difficulties we face when we are promoting human rights protection. We in Sri Lanka faced this during the previous regime when human rights defenders, journalists and social activists, including political leaders, disappeared or they were extrajudicially killed. And we as a South Asian country had relied very much on the UN system to raise the voices of accountability. We in that struggle realized the importance of strengthening the South Asian voices for human rights accountability, and it is in that endeavor that SAHAL took, as soon as the change occurred in Sri Lanka, to host and facilitate this mission. Sri Lanka is facing several challenges with regard to reconciliation, and we all have been working together for peace and reconciliation among the people. But at the same time, we know it has been a difficult task because the South Asian borders are porous, and this is something that we have affirmed, that we have to hold our hands across the borders, even though our leaders would always bring borders as a dividing wall among the people of South Asia. And this mission is a visible action of SAHAL to show the unity among the people of South Asia, but I'm very happy to say that it has been the women in South Asia who have been definitely working for peace. Why women? People will ask. Why don't we have a mixed team? In war and in conflict, the experience women face and men face, we all know, have been different. There is this saying which says, soon after the wars, the guns become silent. The militants and the soldiers, they go back home and they get a rest. But the women who are affected by the war never experience rest, because they are searching for their loved ones. Like in Sri Lanka, hundreds and thousands of women are still searching for they are beloved family members who have disappeared, or their husband or brother or the only breadwinner had been killed. So peace and reconciliation becomes very important for women also in their search for justice and accountability. Even at the UN level, the Security Council has passed UN 1325, where officially the United Nations have recognized that women must be equal partners in peace building efforts and in reconciliation efforts. And in Sri Lanka, at a time when we are talking about developing transitional justice mechanisms, participation of women becomes a challenging issue. Therefore, we invited women from other countries so that we can dialogue. our friends from South Asia, they are from Pakistan, India, Bangladesh, Maldives, Nepal, and we also had two members from Sri Lanka. It's Afghanistan, and we extend a very warm welcome. So we have 1, 2, 3, we have 6 countries from South Asia joining us. Unfortunately, Bhutan has not been a very involved country in that respect. We will invite each of the participants to share their experiences in Sri Lanka. And in relation to this mission, I would also invite them very briefly to share the context they come from in their countries, so that the media can also ask questions. Mulimma mama madhya hitavatunva itamatma sadarein piligannava mema madhya sakachavata me madhya sakachave apikandavannati yedune දකුණු ආසියානු මානව හිමිකම් සංවිධානය ආසියාවේ මානව හිමිකම් ප්‍රවර්ධනයත් අයිතිවාසිකම් සුරැකීමත් සම්බන්ධයෙන් මැදිහත් වීමක යෙදෙන සිවිල් සමාජ ක්‍රියාදාරයන්ගේ ජාලයක් නීතිඥවරුන් මානව හිමිකම් ක්‍රියාදාරයන් සහ ප්‍රජාතන්ත්‍රවාදය වෙනුවෙන් කටයුතු කරන ගෝවිකම්කරු ව්‍යාපාරවල ක්‍රියාකාරීත්වය අවකාශය විශේෂයෙන්ම භාෂණයේ සහ සංගමයේ නිදහස වෙනුවෙන් තමයි අපේගේ මානව හිමිකම් සංවිධානය පෙනී සිටින්නේ විශේෂයෙන්ම ලංකාවේ මේ වන විට සංහිඳියාව හා සාමය සම්බන්ධයෙන් මේ රජය විශේෂ ක්‍රියාදාමයන් ගනු ලබන මොහොතක දකුණු ආසියානු කාන්තාවන්ගේ ඒකාබද්ධතාවය සහ එයාගේ අත්දැකීම් අපගේ මෙම සංක්‍රාන්තික යුක්තිය පිළිබඳ ක්‍රියාදාමයට එක් කර ගැනීමේ අරමුණ ඇතුව තමයි දකුණු ආසියානු මානව හිමිකම් සංවිධානය මෙම කාන්තාවන්ගේ විශේෂ සාම දූත කණ්ඩායම ලංකාවට ආරාධනා කරේ මෙම සාම දූත කණ්ඩායමට අෆ්ගනිස්තානය බංග්ලාදේශය ඉන්දියාව මාලදිවයින නේපාලය පකිස්තානය යන රටවල්වල නියෝජිත වරියන් සහභාගී වෙනවා ඒ සියලුම නියෝජිත වරියන් තමන්ගේ රටේ සාමය සඳහා වන ක්‍රියාදාමයක් මානව හිමිකම් ප්‍රවර්ධනය සඳහා සටනේ ඉතාමත්ම ඉදිරියෙන් කටයුතු කරපු මානව හිමිකම් ක්‍රියාදාරයන් අපි ඒ අයව උතුරු නැගෙනහිර ප්‍රදේශවල විපතටපත් කාන්තාවන් සමග සංවාදයට ඕන්ව අපි ආරාධනා කෙරුවා ඒ වගේම විශේෂයෙන්ම සාමය සම්බන්ධයෙන් කටයුතු කරන සාම කාර්යාංශයක් එක්සත් ජාතීන්ගේ සංවිධානයේ සාමය පිළිබඳ විශේෂ නිලධාරී මහත්මියක් මහත්ම මහත්මින් ඇතුළු රජයේ නිලධාරීනුත් ඔවුන් අපි සම්මවන්නට සැලැස්සුවා මම ඔවුන්ට ආරාධනා කරනවා විශේෂයෙන්ම මේ සාමය පිළිබඳ ක්‍රියාදාමය තුල කාන්තාවන්ගේ සහභාගීත්වයේ තිබෙන වටිනාකමත් ඒ වගේම සාම ක්‍රියාදාමයන් සම්බන්ධයෙන් රජය පියවර ගන්නා විට තම ඔවුන්ගේ රටවල්වල රජය ක්‍රියා කරපු ආකාරයත් එයින් ලංකාවේ සාම ක්‍රියාදාමයක් මේ අවස්ථාවේදී විශේෂයෙන්ම සත්‍ය කොමිසම අතුරුදහන් වූවන් පිළිබඳ කාර්යාංශය වන්දි පූර්ණය සඳහා මේ රජය විශේෂ කාර්යාංශයක් ගොඩනැගීමට බලාපොරොත්තු වන අවස්ථාවේ ඒ වගේම යුක්තිය පසනලීම සඳහා විශේෂ අධිකරණයක් සම්බන්ධයෙන් සංවාදයට ලක්වන අවස්ථාවේදී මේ ක්‍රියාදාමය තුල කාන්තාවන් කොතැනද කියන කාරණාව සම්බන්ධයෙන් අපි මේ සාමදූත මණ්ඩලය හරහා රටේ අවධානයත් සමාජයේ අවධානයත් සිවිල් සමාජයේ අවධානයත් යොමු කිරීමට බලාපොරොත්තු වෙනවා ස්තුති මම දැන් මේ අපේ සහෝදරියන්ට ආරාධනා කරනවා තමන්ගේ අත්දැකීම් අප සමග බෙදා හදා ගන්නා ලෙස
My name is Bushra Gohar and I'm from Pakistan. I'm a former member of parliament from Pakistan and actively involved in politics and human rights and I come from an area which is affected by conflict and terrorism. So it was an experience for us when Saha invited us to be on this peace commission. It was actually to learn from the Sri Lanka experience post-conflict, how it was dealing with the transition. And we found, I went to the northern province with a group, and we found that there were many questions, although many commissions have been formed, but what we heard was that there's no outcome as yet, and people are still waiting for an outcome. There were issues with displacement. People have been displaced for many, many years, and they're still uncertain. There were questions of livelihood. There were questions of post-war security issues that many women experienced. And basically, what they were saying was that we want the truth about the enforced disappearances of their loved ones. And that is something that they wanted the government to respond to. They have high expectations from the new government. And so basically it is a very complex situation that we experienced, and we felt that many women who are still looking for their loved ones are finding that it is an uphill struggle. And many of the things that are happening here in Colombo, it's not really getting to them. So in one day, I think we found it to be a very complex situation, and we feel that more work needs to be done. And there are some recommendations for Saha that we will also give to Saha, but actually we'd like to thank Saha for the opportunity, basically. Thanks.
Well, my name is Amina Mohsin. I teach international relations in Dhaka University, Bangladesh. And I'm grateful to Sahar chapter Sri Lanka for inviting me over, because I thank them for two reasons. A, I've been writing on minority rights and minority issues for a long, long time. Especially, I've been involved with the conflict situation in Chittagong Hill Tracts, Bangladesh, and the post-conflict situation in the Chittagong Hill Tracts context. And I've been coming to Sri Lanka, the International Center for Ethnic Studies, as well as Women and Media Collective, when the peace process in Sri Lanka was going on, to give lectures on the peace process in CHT, in Chittagong Hill Tracts in Bangladesh, how the peace was being was negotiated in the Chittagong Hill Tracts in Bangladesh, and the absence of women from the accord. So it was like, and so this, when I say this, I recognize the fact that how the civil society of Sri Lanka was involved in the entire process of peacemaking, which was absent in the case of Bangladesh. And Nimalka is perfectly right in pointing out that though the countries have borders, but our mental borders, I would think, are quite fluid, and the ideas flow across each other. And in a peace conflict situation, when I come to Sri Lanka and I visit, like I visited the eastern areas yesterday with the team, and the kind of problems that one saw over there are very similar to the problems that one sees in Chittagong Hill Tracts, post-conflict Chittagong Hill Tracts, Bangladesh. But the way the civil society engagement one observes over here, as well as the government initiatives, are really admirable. But that way, I think Sri Lanka is much more ahead of us. But I would also emphasize upon the fact that we are in a post-accord phase where the accord is yet to be implemented. So there are lessons that Sri Lanka can take from Bangladesh. So there are parallels. And when I say that we don't have borders at the cognitive level, I say it with much responsibility, because our problems are more or less the similar. Landlessness, land grabbing, forced disappearances, you don't have the lists. And In a way, one finds, you know, the differences are there, the similarities are there. If there are questions, I'll be willing to answer those. But it has been a very learning experience for me. Thank you.
Namaste. I'm Bharati Silwalgiri, a women's activist from Nepal. For me, this peace mission has been very contextual and relevant, because I come from a country where we've undergone 10 years of armed conflict, which ended on November 2006 through a comprehensive peace accord with the government and the warring Maoists. So the issues that I was able to witness and experience over here were very, very relevant to what we are going through now. And we are also in a transition phase. And on top of that, as you would know, we've experienced three huge earthquakes just this year, starting from 25th April, 26th April, and 12th May. And they were quite devastating. And on top of that, at the moment, with the promulgation of our Republic Constitution on 20th September, we are facing an economic blockade, which is supposed to be unofficial, by India. And that has compounded the hardships that we have been facing, first through the transition period, then through the earthquake, and now when we're trying to get ourselves together. So what I experienced over here, the issues were very similar, because women's role and contribution in the transformation and peace building process, what has happened, as I see, and this is quite universal, that is, in a hurry to broker peace, you know, gender issues get swept under the carpet or they take a back seat. And although women's contribution are unbroken and it goes through a continuum, their issues such as gender-based violence, their practical needs, looking after the household members, as well as the strategic gender interests, which is really representation at the negotiating table for peace and in decision making, as well as representation in meaningful representation in politics, is not taken into account. So during our 3 days, I have learned a lot, firstly through the half-day interaction with a vibrant NGO civil society. We've met men, women, youths and children. We went to Kilinochi and Vavaniya and met them, and there was a sense of desperation and hopelessness, as we also see in Nepal. Their lives have been uprooted and they're not able to make a fresh start in life, and they do not know the truth and they want closure about their families. And we know women are the anchor of families. They are the backbone of economy of the country and also good governance. So all these issues need to be addressed urgently if Sri Lanka is to have positive peace. What we have now in Sri Lanka as well as in Nepal is the absence of armed conflict, which is negative peace. And there is a potential for another armed conflict if we do not address the issues that may appear very, very minuscule in the eyes of the big politicians who make big decisions and broker in the international arena. But these little issues are what really that matter. So I really wish success to the Sri Lankan transition process, and Nepal has a lot to learn. I take back all those learnings, and when we were in Vavaniya, you know, the people over there said, please help us, please take action on behalf of us. And I told them, I don't think we can take any action for you, because I am not a Sri Lankan, but I will advocate your cause. And I think the media will do a lot of justice if you really focus the attention on these issues in order to have everlasting and sustainable peace. Thank you. Good afternoon. I represent Maldives. My name is Nilfa, and I'm from Maldivian Democracy Network, a civil society organization that represents, that works for human rights promotion and democracy. Thank you, Saha, for inviting our organization, and I have learned a lot through my experience. Especially on the day one, where there was a lot of civil society organizations shared their experience with the change of the government, and I'm sure it is a lot of help for me, especially a learning experience for me to take back home, and where I can use back in the Maldives. My experience yesterday's mission to Trincomalee was not directly relevant to me, which is happening in the Maldives. But although it is directly, it's not relevant to me, but I'm sure it is a learning experience for me, and I want to raise their voices here while I am speaking with the other members here. Women, especially the women who are affected post-war situation is a difficult problem that the Sri Lankan government has to tackle seriously, and they have to be very careful in dealing with these situations, especially empowering women to stand up for their own rights, and other international organizations like UN or intergovernmental organizations like UN could help in empowering women and then raise their voices.
Hello, I'm Pragati. I'm a journalist by profession. So every time I'm there, now this time I'm at this time side of the table, so it's a little, I have attention. yesterday we visit, my colleagues explained a lot of things. I will be to the point, and I want to mention one important point which we observed in Sampur village, which is near Trincomalee. It is the village as you are aware of, and in that village during the war time around 800 families displaced. After the war, that means after 2009, now just before 6 months, the families are coming back, and they are settling down. Okay, we could see the families building their own houses, their teen houses, and they are farming, they are cultivating their own land, a small piece of land, and now they are getting the notices to evacuate that land. There are two power plants which are coming there. One is in collaboration with Indian government, and other is in collaboration with Japan. Both the plants require around 5,034 acres land each. Okay, and just before 6 months, those people are coming back. Those are getting their lives back. Those are settling down over there. And government is telling them to evacuate the land and evacuate their houses. There are three families we yesterday met. They are asked to evacuate their whole land. They have got notices from government, and it is literally inhuman. Those families were crying and like that, and what government is giving back to them, it is nothing in return. They are verbally just saying, we will give you 25,000 rupees only, verbally they are saying, and 6 months food. Again, it is under the UN program, not government especially is doing anything for them. And there is a lot of pressure on those families. One of the person was saying he was taken to the police station illegally, and for a whole night he had to stay in that police station. So it is, I request here is the national media, and the things are coming in the local media, in Trincomalee and all, but I think the people were saying it is not that much reflected in the national media. I request you, as a media friends, to consider this issue and to reflect this issue in the national media. So that's all I observed. Thank you.
I'm Humaira Saqib from Afghanistan. I work in Afghan Civil Society Organization Network for Peace. You know, Afghanistan now is in war. During 1 month, we have almost one explosion and bombing, and our government is starting peace negotiation, peace dialogue. They had many trips, you know, to Pakistan for starting peace dialogue, but on that collection, women were absent. Means Axon, had some meeting with our government that women should be part of this negotiation. My experience is in trip of Sri Lanka. We have similar problem in Afghanistan, special women. We should talk together. We should start Afghan dialogue, and should include women to peace negotiation. Thank you.
இந்த நிகழ்ச்சிக்கு என்னை அழைத்த இந்த நிறுவனத்திற்கும் நான் நன்றி சொல்ல கடமைப்பட்டிருக்கேன். மன வேதனையில தான் நான் பேசுறேன். நாங்கள் சென்று சந்தித்த பெண்களை என்னால் மறக்க முடியல. அவங்க பேசினதை என்னால் நினைவுகளே வச்சிருக்க தான் தோணுதே தவிர, இது எல்லாத்துக்கும் இப்போ நான் சொல்லணும் எழுதணும்னு தான் நான் நினைக்கிறேன். இந்த சண்டை நடைபெறுவதற்கு முன்னாலே நான் வந்திருக்கேன், சண்டை நடைபெற்ற பிறகு நான் வந்திருக்கேன். பெண்களை சந்தித்தோம், குழந்தைகளை சந்தித்தோம். பெண்கள் கேட்கறதெல்லாம் எங்கே எங்க வீட்டுக்காரு, எங்கே என் தம்பி, எங்கள் அம்மா எங்கே போனாங்க, என்ன பண்ணீங்க, உண்மையை சொல்லுங்க. எங்களுக்கு உதவி செய்ய யாரும் இல்லை. அரசு உதவி செய்யலை, அரசியல்வாதிகள் உதவி செய்யலை. நாங்கள் மக்களாக இருக்கிறோம் இலங்கையில். எங்களை பிரிக்கிறாங்க, எங்களை டிவைட் பண்ணுறாங்க, எங்களை வாழ விடலை, எங்களுக்கு உணவு இல்லை. இந்திய அரசு வீடு கட்டி கொடுக்குது, வீடு கட்டி கொடுக்குறன்ற பேரில் எங்களுக்கு வீடு கிடைச்சாலும் கடலில் நாங்கள் உடன்பட்டிருக்கோம். பெரிய வட்டி கட்டி நாங்கள் வாழ முடியாமல் இருக்கிறோம். தற்கொலை கூட பண்ணிக்கிட்டு இருக்கோம் எங்கள் சமுதாயத்தில். இலங்கை தமிழர் மக்கள் மத்தியில் இன்னைக்கு வறுமை, பசி, பட்டினி அளவிட முடியாது, கணக்கிட முடியாது. இந்த நிலைமை தொடரணும். மக்களுக்கு அரசியல்வாதிகள் எதுக்கு இருக்கிறாங்க, ஏன் மக்கள் பிரச்சனையை பேச மாட்டேன்றாங்க? அரசியல் கைதிகள் சொல்லி சிறையில் அடைக்கப்பட்டவர்கள் என்ன பண்ணீங்க, ஏன் அவங்களை விடுவிக்கலை? இயக்கம் என்று சொல்லி பெண்கள் தங்களை ஈடுபடுத்தி இன்னும் கூட அடிபட்டு நிறைய பேர் புல்லட் காயத்தோடு வாழ்ந்துக்கிட்டு இருக்காங்க. அவங்களுக்கு என்ன செய்தது இந்த அரசு? அவர்களுக்கு யார் என்ன உதவி செய்வாங்க? ஏன் அவங்களுக்கு பயிற்சி கொடுத்து அரசு வேலை வாய்ப்புகளை கொடுத்து பிற நாடுகளில் இது நடந்திருக்கு? இயக்கம் என்றைக்குமே தோல்வி அடையாது. ஆனா இயக்கத்துல ஈடுபட்ட பெண்களுக்கு நம்ம என்ன செய்தோம்? வாழ்வாதாரம் இல்லாம, சாப்பாடு இல்லாம, வேதனையோட, வலியோட, பயத்தோட திருப்பவும் என்னைக்கு நம்மளை வந்து கைது செய்வாங்களோ என்று காத்துக்கிட்டு இருக்காங்க. என் கணவன் காணவில்லைன்னு சொல்ற பெண்ணு பாதுகாப்பு இல்லை. எந்த நேரமும் சிஐடி வந்து கதவை தட்டிட்டு பாதி ராத்திரியிலும் வந்து அவங்களை சந்திச்சு இல்ல மனு கொடுத்ததுனாலே நாங்க பாதிக்கப்பட்டிருக்கோம்னு பல பெண்கள் சொல்லியிருக்காங்க. இன்னைக்கு இந்த நாடு எல்லாவித வசதியும் கொண்ட வளமையான நாடு. என் மக்களுடைய, தமிழ் மக்களுடைய நிலமெல்லாம் எடுக்கப்பட்டிருக்கு. அவர்களுடைய நிலங்கள் திருப்பி கொடுக்கப்படணும். போரில் ஈடுபட்டு இன்றைக்கு கிராமத்தில் வாழ்ந்துட்டு இருக்க பெண்கள் பயந்துகிட்டு இருக்காங்க. நிறைய சந்தேகத்தின் பேரில் அவங்க கைது செய்யப்படுறாங்க. அது நிறுத்தப்படணும். நேற்று முந்தின நாள் கூட காணாம போயிருக்காங்க ஏன் இந்த நிலைமை தொடர்ந்து நடக்குது இது யார் செய்யறது இதுக்கு யார் பொறுப்பு தமிழ் மக்கள் மக்கள் இலங்கை தமிழர் அவர்களுடைய வேண்டுதல் என்னன்றதை நம்ம கண்டறிந்து அவர்களுக்கு செய்யணும் சும்மா உணவு கொடுக்கறதோ உடை கொடுக்கறதோ பெருசல்ல அவங்களுடைய உரிமைகள் திரும்ப பெறணும் சம உரிமை பெறணும் தமிழ் மக்கள் சிங்கள மக்கள் முகமது இஸ்லாமிய மக்கள் எல்லாருமே மக்கள் தான் மத ரீதியில் அவங்க பிரிக்கப்படக்கூடாது ஒன்று சேர்ந்து வாழ மக்கள் விருப்பப்படுறாங்க மக்கள் விருப்பத்துக்கு ஏற்ப தமிழர்கள் விருப்பத்துக்கு ஏற்ப செயல்படணும் இந்த அரசு அரசுன்றது மக்கள் பேச்சை கேட்டு தான் செயல்படணும் மக்களுக்கு விரோதமாக நடைபெறக்கூடாது மக்களை பிரிக்க வைக்காதீங்க மக்கள் பிரித்தாளப்படுறாங்க இன்னைக்கு பெண்களுக்கு கொடுமை வார் விடோஸ்னு வேற சொல்லிக்கிட்டு அவங்களுக்குன்னு ஒரு இடம் வைத்து அந்த இடம் சரியா பாதுகாக்கப்படலை சாதாரணமாக சமுதாயத்தில் வாழக்கூடிய மக்களுக்கு உடை இல்லை உணவு இல்லை வேலை வாய்ப்பு இல்லை கடன் தொல்லையில் ஈடுபட்டிருக்காங்க 400,000 கடன் பெற்றா 500,000 அவங்க திருப்பி கட்ட வேண்டியிருக்கு அந்த 100,000 அவங்க எங்கேருந்து வேலை செய்து பெற முடியும் மேலும் மேலும் தான் பாதிப்பு இந்த பாதிக்கப்பட்டிருக்கிற போர்னால பாதிக்கப்பட்டிருக்கிற எப்படிப்பட்ட மக்களானாலும் அவங்களுடைய நிலங்கள் திரும்பி அவங்களுக்கு கொடுக்கணும் அரசு வந்து இந்திய அரசை நம்பி இந்திய அரசு வீடு கட்டி கொடுக்குதுன்னு சொல்லி இருந்து கூடாது இந்திய அரசு கட்டி கொடுக்குற வீடுகள் முடிக்கப்படலை அது இன்னும் கம்ப்ளீட் ஆகலை இந்த மக்களுக்கு இலங்கை அரசு மேற்கொண்டு பணம் கொடுத்து நல்ல வீடுகளை அவர்களுக்கு கட்டி கொடுக்கணும் நிலம் கொடுக்கணும் வாழ்வாதாரத்தை அவங்களுக்கு கொடுக்கணும் இந்த மக்களுக்கு வேலை வாய்ப்பு உருவாக்கி கொடுக்கணும் வேலை செய்ய நிறைய இளைஞர்கள் கொழும்புக்கு வந்திருக்காங்க மொழி பிரச்சனை அரசு அலுவலகங்களில் மொழி பிரச்சனை இருக்குது இந்த மொழி பிரச்சனைக்கு என்ன நடவடிக்கை எடுக்க போறீங்க தமிழ் மக்கள் வாழ்ற இடத்துல தமிழ் அதிகாரிகளும் இருக்கணும் அவர்களுக்கு சிங்களம் புரியவில்லை அவர்கள் மனு கொடுத்தாலும் ஏற்றுக்கொள்ளப்படலை மொழி பிரச்சனை ஒரு பெரிய பிரச்சனையா இருக்குது இந்த சமுதாயத்தில் இந்த மக்களுக்கு எந்த விதத்தில் எப்படி செய்யணும்னு எல்லா வித கன்சல்டேஷன்ல நீங்க பேசணும் நேரடியாக அங்கே போய் பார்க்கணும் பாதிக்கப்பட்ட உரிமை வேணும் தன்னாட்சி வேணும்னு ஆசைப்பட்டு களத்தில் இறங்கின இளைய பெண்களுக்கு வேலை வாய்ப்பு அரசு வேலை வாய்ப்பு கொடுத்து அவங்களுடைய வாழ்வு மேம்பாதார வளமடைய செய்யணும் அச்சையில் அப்படிதான் செய்திருக்காங்க போராட்டத்தில் ஈடுபட்ட இயக்கத்தில் ஈடுபட்டவங்களுக்கு வேலை வாய்ப்பு கொடுத்து இல்லைன்னா திருப்பி அவர்கள் பாதிக்கப்பட்டு போராட்ட உணர்வுக்குள்ள அதிகமாக தூண்டப்படுவாங்க பேசுறதுக்கு வாய்ப்பு கொடுத்ததுக்கு நன்றி I'm so happy that I joined this peace mission. It is very painful for me. I visited these areas even before the war and after the war. No changes taking place. The women whom I met, our team met, is really suffering. There is no security. And they are asking only one thing. What happened to my son? What has happened to my husband? I don't know where to find him. I know to whom I handed over my son. I know the person, even the military, the army. I know the name of the officer. What happened? Where could I go and search for my son? My husband. This is the question raised by our women. And there is no security for these women. When they talk about disappearance, they met 15 commissions. Petitioned to all the commissions. Nothing happened. One sister shared with me, when they were crying in front of the commission participants, those who participated, not our commission, the government commission, they were sleeping. This is the society that we are living in. We don't feel the pain that our people are facing it today. And our women are indebted because the Indian government has come forward to give them houses. But that money is not enough. So they're borrowing money from the private banks, which is charging them very big interest. And this is a weekly repayment. Where will they go without any employment to repay the loans? No security. And children are suffering. They want to be educated. Where will they go for money to educate these children? I feel the political prisoners should be released. And I feel those who were involved in the war and now having a normal life should be given job by the government like it was done in Aceh. Otherwise, there will be fear among people and there will be struggles once again. I feel the government should take a strong step to see that this change that is taking place is very helpful, and the people should be given their lands which they have lost during the war. Whoever it is, at Puttalam, the Muslim Tamils wanted to go back to their land. They are treated as migrants, which is not good. We all belong to this land and we are still feel like as though we are refugees. And no food, no shelter, no education for children. People have a lot of health problems. This bombing burnt women. There is one woman who was burnt. She was forced to sign a petition saying that she burnt herself. The people who got the signed petition, because they threatened her, unless you sign, we will not let your husband who is arrested. Once the husband was sent out of jail, after getting the petition signed by this woman, the husband left her because she was burnt. Why these things are happening? And injustice to women all the time. And we have to talk about women who are leaving this country as domestic workers. How many problems that you have been dealing with? We have to talk about the fishermen folks, fisher folks between Tamil Nadu and Sri Lanka and Bangladesh, in Asian countries. These are also issues that we have to see. I feel that the situation, the war-affected women, children, the community, is not getting their normal life. They are not living in peace. I think peace has to come to this land by all of us joined together. We have to create a strong people's movement to resist and to find justice. Justice is not given unless social transformation takes place. It is the structures that are doing all this injustice to people who are divided into different countries. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the sharing. It's very much true. After this mission, is there any idea to appeal to our president, to big person, as a, especially you are a women group, very strong. Is there any idea?
This mission was conducted in the initial stages when Sri Lanka is moving towards developing mechanisms for transitional justice. In my earlier presentation, I did mention that we want to highlight the importance of involving women in developing the transitional justice mechanisms in Sri Lanka. We invited the South Asian women to be with us so that their experiences, their insights and their solidarity will be with the women in Sri Lanka who are struggling for justice and accountability. Yes, this report that we will receive from the mission will be handed over not only to the President of Sri Lanka, to the Prime Minister, the Foreign Minister, and for the relevant UN bodies, because it is very important issues have been highlighted in this mission. The most important being that women who have been affected by the war still feel left out, and they have not been consulted when decisions are made in Colombo. So what is happening in Colombo and what is happening in Kilinochi and Sampur are not connected. There is a big gap between all the words the politicians in Colombo are saying, but in reality, the families of the disappeared, the internally displaced who are coming back, are not experiencing a normal life. They still feel they are threatened as a result of the security considerations. They are still afraid to talk about their pain. they are still afraid to talk about the suffering they have faced during the war. So we have tried by bringing women from other countries, from Afghanistan, from Pakistan, politicians, women's rights activists from South India, peace researchers from Bangladesh, journalists from India, young activists from Maldives, and peace activists from Nepal, so that the women who are wanting justice in Sri Lanka will know, especially the Tamil and the Muslim women in the North and East will know that our interventions for peace is not done alone. That this issue of peace in Sri Lanka is also important for South Asia. And this is what Sahar wanted to convey through this mission, that we in Sri Lanka as women activists, when we are struggling to make transitional justice mechanisms, Truth Commission may be mission, the disappearances office, reparation and accountability cannot be meaningful to women if women are not involved in designing and implementing. And all the war-affected women whom they met have said that the commissions appointed by Sri Lanka president in the past was not effective. They have said that some of the commission members were sleeping while the commission sittings were happening. So this is why we are going to appeal to Sri Lankan government, if they are setting up mechanisms, these mechanisms must be much more effective and meaningful to the people affected by war, and especially women. We will hand over our report to the Sri Lankan government. We are happy that we are able to meet in this hotel without surveillance and the CID. The difference between last year and this year for human rights activists is that. But we also are aware of the fact that though human rights activists in the South can move and work freely, the same atmosphere is not there in the North and East. But the situation has eased. We have a human rights commission that is appointed through the Constituent Assembly, through the Constitutional Council. We've appointed a new Constitutional Council. There is change in Sri Lanka. There is change in Sri Lanka. We can talk about human rights without ministers and political leaders telling us that they will break our legs and break our hands. There were ministers in the previous government who threatened to kill us and threatened to break our legs if we spoke out like this. Today, we can send a South Asian mission like this to Kilinochi and Sampur without fearing that the people whom they met in Kilinochi and Sampur will not be threatened. And if they are threatened, they can inform us and we can inform the Prime Minister and the President and the Foreign Minister of this country and say that we are involved, we as women have the right to be involved in discussing and planning transitional justice and accountability mechanisms in Sri Lanka. That's the change. there is a change in Sri Lanka, but we want women also, women affected by war, the Tamil, the Muslim and the Sinhala women affected by war to have fuller and equal participation in building peace, human rights and security in Sri Lanka. We also know that we are urging for security sector reforms, we are urging for legal sector reforms. I am not saying everything changed within 24 hours in Sri Lanka, but we now have space to bring ideas to the government. We can be in dialogue with the government and we definitely have to ensure that we establish good governance in real sense in Sri Lanka. ප්‍රශ්නේ ඇහුවේ ලංකාවේ වෙනසක් සිදු වී තිබෙනවද කියලා. මම මානව හිමිකම් ක්‍රියාධාරයක හැටියට සන්තෝෂයෙන් පවසනවා අපේ දකුණු ආසියානු මානව හිමිකම් ක්‍රියාධාරයන් ඉදිරියේ අද වෙනකොට අපි මානව හිමිකම් ගැන කතා කරුවාට අපේ ට පහර දෙන්න අපේ අතපය කඩනවයි කියලා මේ රටේ ඇමතිවරුන්ට කියන්න හැකියාවක් නැහැ. එදා අපි මානව හිමිකම් ගැන කතා කරපුවාම කැබිනට් මන්ත්‍රීවරු නියෝජ්‍ය ඇමතිවරු අපේ අතපය කඩනවයි කියලා තර්ජනය කෙරුවා. අපි මානව හිමිකම් ගැන කතා කරුවේ මහත් බයකින්. නමුත් අද දකුණු ආසියාවේ මානව හිමිකම් ක්‍රියාධාරයන් පිරිසකට කිලිනොච්චියට ගිහිල්ලා සාම්පූර් ප්‍රදේශවලට ගිහිල්ලා යුද්ධයෙන් පීඩාවටපත් කාන්තාවන් සමග සාකච්ඡා කළා. මුළු සාමය ගොඩනැගීම පිළිබඳ ලංකාවේ ක්‍රියාදාමයට දකුණු ආසියාවේ කාන්තාවනුත් සහභාගී කරගෙන ඉදිරියට යන්න පුළුවන් අවකාශයක් අවස්ථාවක් අපිට ලැබිලා තියෙනවා. මේ සාමය ගොඩනැගීම පිළිබඳ කාරණාව හුදෙක් ලංකාවට විතරක් වටින කාරණාවක් නෙමෙයි. ලංකාවේ සාමය ගොඩනැගීම පිළිබඳ කාරණාව ඉන්දියාවටත් නේපාලයටත් පකිස්තානයටත් අෆ්ගනිස්තානයටත් ආදර්ශයක් වේවයි කියන ප්‍රාර්ථනාවෙන් තමයි අපි මේ සාමදූත කටයුත්ත කෙරුවේ. ඉතින් වෙනස තමයි මේ වෙනස ලංකාවේ කාන්තාවන්ගේ විශේෂයෙන්ම යුද්ධයෙන් විපතටපත් සිංහල දෙමළ මුස්ලිම් සියලු කාන්තාවන්ගේම අනාගතය එකට ගොඩනගන ක්‍රියාදාමයක් විය යුතුයි කියන කාරණාව තමයි අපි අවධානය කරන්නේ. විශේෂයෙන්ම සාමය ගොඩනැගීම ලංකාවේ පිරිමින්ට විතරක් අයිති කාරණාවක් නෙමෙයි. දේශපාලනේ අද වැඩියෙන් ඉන්නේ පිරිමි නායකයෝ. දේශපාලන තීන්දුව ගන්නේ පුරුෂයෝ. පුරුෂාධිපත්‍යක දේශපාලන රටාවක් තියෙන්නේ. මෙවැනි කාන්තා සාම දූත කණ්ඩායමක් අපි ලංකාවට ගෙනල්ලා මේ ආරම්භ කරන්නේ සාමයේ ඇත්ත අර්ථය 52ක් වන ලංකාවේ කාන්තාවන්ට භුක්ති විඳින්න අයිතියක් තිබෙන බව ප්‍රකාශ කිරීම සහ ඒ පිළිබඳ දේශපාලන නායකත්වයට යම් අභියෝගයක් එල්ල කිරීම තමයි අපේ බලාපොරොත්තුව. What I explained was there is a change in Sri Lanka. Today we are able to meet freely and we are able to talk about with South Asian women and South Asian human rights defenders about designing a peace where women matters, that women can come together, women in South Asia can come together to Sri Lanka and talk with women affected by war, the Muslim women, the Sinhala women and the Tamil women very freely. And we are not afraid to talk very openly, because in the earlier days, if we have a meeting like this, government ministers would have threatened to break our legs and to kill us. And we would have, if you are talking about peace, the state controlled media would have shown our pictures as traitors. The two media, these are the two media units that showed my face as a traitor. Today, the same media unit will come when we invite, because they are interested about carrying this message for peace and reconciliation to the wider Sinhala speaking and Tamil speaking community in Sri Lanka. That's the change, and that is what good governance means to us, to be able to freely discuss how peace should be
facilitated in Sri Lanka, how reconciliation could be facilitated in Sri Lanka. So therefore, it is very important for us to continue this dialogue. This report will be shared with the President and the Prime Minister and the Foreign Minister and the government leaders, and we want to appeal that women in Sri Lanka become part of reconciliation building process. And the war-affected women, their concerns, they are called to find their family members who have disappeared, must become priority in the peace-building agenda of Sri Lanka. They have very openly said that the commission sittings, the previous commission sittings, that they saw how the commissioners are sleeping while these commissions were meeting. We don't want that kind of commission to be instituted in Sri Lanka in the future. We want commissions that will bring meaningful responses to the women who have suffered a lot in Sri Lanka. And what we are urging, that if you are building peace, the political framework in Sri Lanka is very patriarchal. The decisions are made by men. We also want women's political participation enhanced when we are talking about peace building and reconciliation in Sri Lanka. That is why we have a women's peace mission brought to South Asia, so that peace building in Sri Lanka also becomes an agenda in South Asia. That peace building in Afghanistan, peace building in Pakistan, and peace building in Sri Lanka or peace building in Nepal are not isolated events. That we want it to be meaningful when we are talking about people's movement and people's right in South Asia.
Thank you, Nirmala. Because I'm from Nepal and we went through insurgency. Even that insurgency, we could be human rights activists, we could gather and talk about it. And that time it was like, I think it's a fearful situation like that. But when I was last year, when I was meeting like from one of the persons, to pronounce human rights in public was a crime, and I was suffocating. And then when I saw it, it's really nice.
Thank you.